Welcome to This Week in Amateur Radio, your weekly all-amateur radio news and technology bulletin service and podcast, where we cover all things radio. Here are the stories for release around the earth as we come to air with edition number 1205 of This Week in Amateur Radio. The FCC issues a clarification on the new $35 application fee at the request of the ARRL. We will have all the details. France takes action against a radio amateur for bad on-the-air activity with both jail time, a hefty fine, and equipment confiscation. Kerry Blank, N6IZW, is going to be honored with the 2022 Hamvention Special Achievement Award. Amateur radio gear is on its way to the new Chinese space station. WTWW, a shortwave station in Tennessee, is broadcasting both music and messages to listeners in the Ukraine. A new whisper beacon is now on the air from Antarctica. A few amateurs in the United Kingdom have been granted access to 8 meters, that's 40 megahertz. A banquet dinner at the upcoming Dayton Hamvention will honor APRS developer Bob Barunga. And radio manufacturers are considering what has proven to be a controversial change to new models of transceivers. We will have all the details coming up in this week's report. These headline stories will come to you in a moment, along with this week's special features. Australia's own Arnold Benshop, VK6FLAB, will have tips on planning for your next emergency. We will visit with Bruce Page, KK5DO, and get an update from AMSAT and what's new with all of those amateur satellites in orbit. Our technology reporter, Leo Laporte, W6TWT, will tell us about a computer museum that recently got destroyed in the Ukraine, how the FCC has placed Kaspersky antivirus on its security risk list. The European Union places new requirements on Apple and Google, including third-party sideloading of apps. And on a sad note, Leo will say goodbye to the inventor of the GIF and the inventor of the Trash 80 computer. Our own amateur radio historian, Bill Continelli, W2XOI, returns with yet another edition of the Ancient Amateur Archives. This week, Bill takes us back to the year 1978, as it was the year that 300,000 amateurs versus 9 million citizens band operators who both want expanded frequencies. And our tower climbing and antenna master, Greg Stoddard, KF9MP, presents part 5 of his 6-part series, explaining how to get your club meeting or hamfest promoted on local broadcast radio by correctly composing and submitting a public service announcement. All of that and a whole lot more is straight ahead as North America's premier amateur radio and technology news magazine and bulletin service, This Week in Amateur Radio, takes to the air right now. Reporting from sunny Albany, New York, at our headquarters studio, I'm George, W2XBS.
And reporting from the newsroom in Half Moon, New York, I'm Terry Saunders, N1KIN.
And reporting from our news bureau just outside Albany, New York, in the Geek Cave Studios, I'm Rich Lawrence, KB2MOB.
And reporting this week from the sleepy little town of Cortlandville, New York, I'm Chris Perrine, KB2FAF.
And reporting from our news bureau in Rochester, New York, along the southern shore of Lake Ontario, I'm Dave Wilson, WA2HOY.
And reporting from Archway, New York News Bureau, I'm Eric, KD2RJX.
And reporting from our amateur radio station in the Catskill Mountains of upstate New York, where our mailbox is full of happy little seeds and happy little seed catalogs, I'm Don Hulick, K2ATJ.
And now with this week's lead story, here is Terry Saunders, N1KIN.
We have an update to our lead story from last week regarding the new $35 FCC application fee. With more details on this latest clarification, we go to Steve Ford, WB8IMY, reporting from League headquarters.
The Federal Communications Commission staff has clarified, in response to an ARRL request, that the new $35 application fee will not apply to most license modifications, including those to upgrade an amateur radio licensee's operator class and changes to club station trustees. The FCC staff explained that the new fees will apply only to applications for a new license, a renewal, rule waiver, or a new vanity call sign. As previously announced, the new fees take effect on April 19, 2022. ARRL Voluntary Examiner Coordinator Manager Marie Soma, AB1FM, said, quote, "We are pleased that the FCC will not charge licensees the FCC application fee for the license upgrade applications. While applicants for a new license will need to pay the $35 FCC application fee, there'll be no FCC charge for future upgrades and administrative updates such as change of mailing or email address. Most current licensees, therefore, will not be charged the new FCC application fee until they renew their license or apply for a new vanity call sign." Close quote.
ARRL previously reported that the new $35 application fee for amateur radio licenses will become effective on April 19, 2022. Further information and instructions about the new FCC application fee are available from the ARRL VEC.
The Court of Versailles sentenced a 65-year-old resident of La Flossée to a one-year suspended prison sentence Monday on March 28, 2022. The radio amateur had transmitted insulting, threatening, and homophobic remarks. With more details on this story, we go across the Atlantic to Steve Richards, G4HPE, who files this report through the facilities of the Southgate News Service.
The man was sentenced by the court on Monday, March 28, 2022. This radio amateur was the target of several complaints from all over France for comments he made on the air. For several months, the defendant had made insulting and homophobic remarks. The sexagenarian had also falsely announced the death of a man on Facebook. The victim said that people who knew him had even called the town hall where he lives to find out when the funeral was. The offender, who had not even taken care to hide his amateur radio call sign, had been easily identified. Local media said that he'd been arrested for the first time by the gendarme in December 2020. His transmitting equipment, which was not certified, had been seized. He was arrested again on January the 7th this year for non-compliance with the judicial control that banned him from obtaining and installing amateur radio equipment. The defendant was finally sentenced to 1 year in prison, with a probationary suspension of 2 years. He was also prohibited from engaging in the activity of amateur radio and was required to pay a fine of €5,000 to two plaintiffs.
AMSAT has received a generous grant from Amateur Radio Digital Communications for the development of a 3U space frame with deployable solar panels. This standardized 3U CubeSat space frame will serve as the mechanical platform for AMSAT's Greater Orbit, Larger Footprint, or Golf series of satellites, as well as for a new generation of Low Earth Orbit LEO FM satellites. Central to the development of the 3U space frame, AMSAT will build three flight-ready space frames for an upcoming series of satellites with potentially enhanced flight control, payload, and communication capabilities. The need for a 3U space frame with deployable solar panels goes back to the original design requirements for the Gulf satellites that would return AMSAT to highly elliptical orbits. The benefit of this program will provide satellites with wider coverage and longer access times to the entire amateur radio satellite community worldwide.
On March 17th, the European Conference of Postal and Telecommunications, better known as the CEPT, announced the indefinite suspension of Belarus and the Russian Federation in a sweeping action that has an impact on amateur radio operators. Steve Richards, G4HPE, has more in this report filed through the Southgate News Service in the UK.
The CEPT was formed in 1959 to coordinate European state communications and postal services. Part of its work includes harmonizing the standard of amateur radio examinations and licenses within Europe. There are 400,000 radio amateurs located in CEPT countries, including Ukraine, Russia, and Belarus. The CEPT announcement said that based on a request from a number of CEPT members, the CEPT presidency carried out a written procedure in accordance with the CEPT arrangement on the proposal to suspend indefinitely and with immediate effect the memberships of the Russian Federation and Belarus. 34 responses were received to the CEPT assembly letter in support of the proposal and one abstention. Based on this, the CEPT Assembly has therefore decided to suspend indefinitely the memberships of the Russian Federation and Belarus. The suspension of the said CEPT members took effect as from midnight Central European time on the 18th of March 2022. Any future readmission to the CEPT would follow the usual rules established in the CEPT arrangement, notably the need for a two-thirds majority of members of the CEPT to endorse such a decision. The CEPT presidency requested the office to take all necessary measures in order to set in place these decisions. And there's more in the news section at cept.org. And in Poland, there has been an announcement from the SPDX Contest Committee, who said that after careful consideration, together with the Polish Amateur Radio Union, the PZK, and the SPDX Club, they've decided to cancel the 2022 SPDX Contest. Since the start of the war in Ukraine, Poland has accepted nearly 2 million refugees to date, as a direct result of Russian aggression towards their neighbouring country. This is an unprecedented event in Europe and has resulted in the greatest migration crisis in Europe since World War II. Polish people are deeply engaged in all forms of humanitarian assistance. Polish radio amateurs are giving shelter to Ukrainian refugees in their homes and offering their help and services in every way possible. Under these extraordinary circumstances, the SPDX Contest Committee felt it was most appropriate to cancel the SPDX Contest this year. There's more at spdxcontest.pzk.org.pl.
An agreement with the CEPT conference grants amateur radio privileges to qualifying hams traveling between signatory countries without the need to obtain additional permits or licenses. The CEPT was formed to foster the cooperation among its member nations with regard to postal and electronic communications. The Russian Federation joined CEPT in 1994. Belarus became a member in 2003. The CEPT Assembly also decided that any future readmission to the CEPT would follow the usual rules established in the CEPT agreement, notably the need for a two-thirds majority of members of the CEPT to endorse such a decision.
The Hamvention Awards Committee recently announced that Kerry Banke, N6IZW, has won the 2022 Hamvention Special Achievement Award for his efforts in design, development, manufacturing, and human spaceflight certification of the ARISS Multi-Voltage Power Supply, or MVPS. The ARIS Multi-Voltage Power Supply is a foundational element of the ARIS Next Generation Radio System, which is now on orbit. The Hamvention Special Achievement Award is given each year to a deserving amateur that's made an outstanding contribution advancing the art and or science. Now retired, Banke spent most of his career in the research and development of electronic systems as a microwave RF electrical engineer. This included 14 years as a Qualcomm engineer developing innovative microwave wireless technologies. Kerry's electronic interests span DC to light, with particular interest and expertise in microwaves. His ham radio operations have included transmissions on the 136 kHz through laser band. Since 1982, he served as a host of San Diego's Microwave Group's monthly meetings, sharing his expertise with other hams of like interest. Mr. Banke's exceptional support to the Human Spaceflight Amateur Radio began in 1994, where he served as a school technical mentor and certified ground station for the Shuttle Amateur Radio Experiment. When NASA transitioned from the Shuttle to the International Space Station, Kerry became an exemplary member of the Amateur Radio and the International Space Station hardware team. For 7 years, working from his home and electronics lab in La Mesa, California, Banke led the circuit design, breadboarding, flight circuit board layout, assembly, and device testing of the ARIS multi-voltage power supply, which occupies a volume roughly the size of two stacked reams of paper and can connect to different ISS power sources from 120 volts DC to 28 volts DC and simultaneously power up to 18 devices with multiple voltage level needs. ARIS USA Executive Director Frank Bauer said the ARIS team is proud of Kerry's sustained exemplary support to ARIS. His contributions to our next generation radio system are transformative, enabling expanded ARIS operations for ham radio operators and enhanced STEM, science, technology, and engineering, and math, educational outcomes for youth. Through this system, 60 to 80 foreign and domestic era school contracts are conducted each year, with 150,000 to 200,000 students, teachers, and members of the public engaged. Amateur radio operators also enjoy over 100,000 digital and voice repeater connections from this radio system every year.
According to NBC News, shortwave radio signals coming from the United States have been sending comfort in the form of music and recorded messages of hope to people in Ukraine and Russia. Using the power of a 100,000-watt shortwave transmitter in Tennessee, two radio amateurs are using the additional power of rock and roll to send some upbeat moments to the people of Ukraine and Russia. Ted and Holly Randall, WB8PUM and KG4WXV, operate shortwave AM broadcast station WTWW, located in a warehouse building from their nearby home. The transmitter is overseen by the couple's son, David, KG4WXW. The studio is located in a small room in the couple's house. Music isn't the only thing the couple has been transmitting. They are broadcasting recorded messages left by callers to the radio station, carrying messages of hope and encouragement to be received on the small shortwave receivers many of the Ukrainian listeners have. Ted Randall told the local TV station, WVLT, these people are listening in bunkers. They are listening in shelters and those little battery-powered or wind-up radios. That's the type of radios they're listening on. As a ham, Ted also recognizes that radio's power goes beyond any mere measurement in wattage. He told the TV station news reporter, if we can touch lives through radio, then that's our responsibility.
AmSat Argentina has assembled and delivered a permanent whisper or weak signal propagation reporter beacon system to the Argentine research station at Esperanza Base on the Antarctic Peninsula. Using the call sign LU1ZV, the 200 milliwatt beacon is presently active on 40, 20, 15, and 10 meters at 7.0386, 14.0956, 21.0946, and 28.1246 megahertz, respectively, and reception has been reported by stations throughout the world. The LU1ZV Whisper Beacon is on the air from Esperanza Base, a permanent Antarctic research station. Whisper is a digital communication protocol designed for reception at very weak signal levels. It is part of the WSJTX software suite. You can use WSJTX to receive the LU1ZV beacon directly, or you can see reports from other stations online at www.whispernet.org. That's www.wsprnet.org.
Denmark's National Amateur Radio Society, the EDR, has joined others in banning radio amateurs in Russia and Belarus from participating in any EDF contest or ARDF event. A translation of the statement issued by the EDF reads, "The Russian Federation's invasion of Ukraine on February 24th and the events that resulted from it have given rise to many thoughts also among radio amateurs around the world. How should we behave? Until this conflict, the amateur radio community has always tried to be apolitical and impartial in relation to conflicts around the world. It is clear that the Russian Federation and Belarus, with their military operation into a sovereign and democratic European Ukraine, have crossed a border for acceptable behavior. Therefore, like other European associations, the EDR cannot remain neutral. We must deal with the conflict without escalating it. The policy of the EDR is that we will follow the actions of the mainstream sports organizations with regard to all activities of a competitive nature, such as contests and fox hunting, organized by the Russian Federation and Belarus. Russian and Belarusian radio amateurs are therefore not currently eligible to participate in any event organized or sponsored by EDR. EDR's policy in commercial activities is that we will refrain from trade with the Russian Federation and Belarus until further notice. Since amateur radio is an individual hobby, and the individual radio amateur decides for himself how he wants to practice it, EDR will be neutral in relation to the attitude of individual EDR members. If some of our members want to participate in competition organized by Russian organizations, or have contact with Russian radio amateurs, it is the individual member's sovereign choice. EDR members should also be aware of the situation of Ukrainian radio amateurs. They have been banned from broadcasting since February 24th in accordance with the exemption law passed by the Ukrainian parliament as a result of the invasion. In principle, any radio amateur currently broadcasting from Ukraine risks his life. If you are listening to a Ukrainian station, you should definitely not shout about it. Dissemination of call signals, locations, and frequencies, whether on a tape or in a cluster, should be avoided in any case. In the current situation, the best thing we can do is listen. We should not try to call Ukrainian radio amateurs. The EDR's calendar will not include contests and other events organized by associations domiciled in the Russian Federation or Belarus as long as the current situation exists. For EDR competitions, so far all logs received from stations in the Russian Federation or Belarus will be treated as check logs.
John Desmond, EI7GL, reports that Ofcom, the communications regulator in the United Kingdom, has granted temporary innovation and research licenses to several UK amateurs to transmit in the 40 MHz band or 8 meters. On his blog, John stated that Roger Lapthorne, GE3XBM, in the east of England, will be operating beginning on April 2nd with a license that's valid for 1 year. In a statement, Roger said, "After a very long wait, Ofcom has approved my 8-meter permit. It permits me to use 40 to 42 MHz with digital modes, including CW, at 5 watts ERP maximum. I expect to erect a wired dipole that will be directed towards Europe, and expect it to be mostly on FT8, around 40.676 MHz, with a precise frequency done in liaison with others. My hope is that all 8-meter FT8 stations can be monitored with one USB dial setting, but spaced out. 5 watts should only cover Europe when sporadic E is in play, and we'll try some local CW crossband QSOs, but hope to be on FT8 24/7.
Shepherd Media has published an item about the use of HF communications by the Russian troops invading Ukraine. It turns out that the Russian army relies heavily on HF radio. Using transmissions in the range 3 to 30 MHz, HF signals transverse beyond line-of-sight ranges because they bounce off the ionosphere back to Earth, like a snooker ball bouncing off the table's cushion. This phenomenon means that HF transmissions can reach ranges of thousands of miles. Several HF radios are said to be in service with the Russian army during its ongoing invasion of Ukraine, such as the R166 Artec and the R176 Ante, HF and VHF vehicle-mounted or static sight radios. These may carry voice and light traffic for the Akatsia-M C2 system, which is deployed at command level within the Russian Combined Arms Armies. Russia has 11 such formations spread across 4 military districts. HF may also be used for trunk communications within the maneuver force. A great deal of unencrypted HF military traffic has been observed on Russian Army HF networks since the invasion of Ukraine began on the 24th of February. The radio amateur community has documented military HF traffic on frequencies of 4.2 to 7.8 MHz. The International Business Times has reported that Ukraine may have managed to get its hands on one of Russia's most prized weapons, a module of the Kremlin's advanced 1RL-257 Krasuka 4 mobile electronic warfare system. The defending Ukraine troops seized a curious container near Kyiv, which is said to hold the command post of the system, according to UK-based military analysts group Ukraine Weapons Tracker. According to military sources, Krasuka 4 can cause damage to the enemy's electronic warfare systems and communications and neutralize low Earth orbits by satellites, ground-based radars, and airborne warning and control system radars at ranges between 150 to 300 kilometers. A complete Krasuka 4 consists of two vehicles, both based on the 8x8 Kamaz 6350 truck, one with the electronic warfare radar jamming system and the other carrying the command post module. It's reportedly the second truck that is now with the Ukrainians. You can read more on the International Business Times website at www.ibtimes.com.
The 2021 ARRL Herb S. Breyer Award for Instructor of the Year was given to recipient Dave Ritter, ND4MR, during the ARRL Forum at the Charlotte, North Carolina Hamfest on Saturday, March 12th. Continuously licensed since age 14, Dave is retired and living in Wilkesboro, North Carolina. ARRL sponsors this award in conjunction with the Lake County, Indiana Amateur Radio Club in Breyer's memory to recognize superior amateur radio instruction and recruitment. An ARRL member for nearly 40 years, Ritter is an ARRL registered instructor and a full-time faculty member at Wilkes Community College, where he's been the lead and sole technician licensing course instructor since 2010.
If you're going to Hamvention, get your tickets early for the AMSAT and Taper Banquet. One of the highlights of Dayton Hamvention weekend this May is expected to be the AMSAT and Taper Banquet, which is being held in honor of Automatic Packet Reporting System pioneer Bob Berninga, WB4APR. Bob, who became a silent key in February, developed this widely used packet system more than a quarter century ago, enabling real-time tracking and data transfer over amateur radio frequencies. The dinner is taking place on Friday, May 20th at 6:30 p.m. local time and will showcase Bob's life and achievements. Tickets are $57 each and must be pre-purchased no later than Friday, May 13th from the AMSAT store. They will not be sold at the AMSAT booth. The banquet will take place at the Kohler Presidential Banquet Center in Kettering, Ohio, a 20-minute drive from Hamvention at the fairgrounds in Zinnia.
And now with the latest technology news and commentary from Petaluma, California. This Week in Amateur Radio is proud to present Leo Laporte.
You got Leo right now. Your personal tech guy. Now I'm mad. The Russian invasion of Ukraine has taken another victim, a historic computer museum. In Mariupol, I didn't know this, there was a guy collecting Soviet-era computers. More than 500 pieces dating as far back as the 50s. It's taken its collector a decade to put together this collection of, it's called Club 8-Bit. Fortunately, the creator of the museum is fine. He's lost his home and he's lost the collection, which is sad. It has been reported that the Mariupol Computer Museum in Ukraine, a privately owned collection of over 500 items of retro computing consoles and technologies from the 50s to the early 2000s, the tweet read, a collection nearly 20 years in the making has been destroyed by a bomb. I'm sorry. That's just one more reason to be mad as heck. There are some great computer history museums in the world, mostly, I think, in Silicon Valley. Although, I'll never forget in Tokyo seeing a collection of old Japanese calculators, including one, a digital calculator that had a abacus attached to it so that, you know, to make the transition easy. So that people were used to using abacuses or abacai. I don't know what the Japanese word is, but we're able to, you know, I can still use the abacus. Oh, look, let's check the calculator, see if it's right. Oh, it is. Okay, it is. FCC has placed Kaspersky, more Russian news, the Russian antivirus company, on its security risk list. There's always been a lot of talk about Kaspersky. Is this really safe to use? This is the first non-Chinese company placed on this list. China Telecom and China Mobile were also added. Once a company's on the list, federal subsidies can't be used to purchase the equipment or services from that company. You know, Kaspersky himself, there's a guy, Eugene Kaspersky, has always said, we are not Russian. Well, we are Russian, but we are not slaves to the Russian government, blah, blah, blah. But if they're in Russia, of course, you know, how much choice do they have? 400 million users, 240,000 companies use Kaspersky antivirus. The company says, we're disappointed. Yes, I can't lie. We're disappointed. A response to the geopolitical climate rather than a comprehensive evaluation of the integrity of Kaspersky's products and services. Well, yeah, that's probably true. No smoking gun, you know. Kaspersky, the company said, will continue to assure its partners and customers on the quality and integrity of its products. But really, come on. Really? You can't. Russian law requires a company to cooperate with the FSB, the big spy agencies like the CIA of Russia. Yeah, I guess it's like the CIA's closest analog. And so back in 2017, the White House said Kaspersky's software is an unacceptable risk. On March 16th, the chairman of the FCC, Jessica Rosenworcel, said the agency had completed a review of Russian interests in U.S. communications networks and shared findings with national security officials. That's all we'll tell you. Okay, I won't use it. You know, it was a very good, I guess it still is, antivirus in its time, but you're right. One of the things it does, and many antiviruses do this, when it finds something suspicious, it sends it back to the servers in Russia for analysis. And at least in one case, that included NSA hacking tools. An NSA contractor had brought home first black mark on his record. Brought it home, not supposed to do that. And then he had Kaspersky running on his personal computer. Kaspersky says, well, these are suspicious. These look like they could be used for hacking. Send them back to Russia. The Russians got them. And it's believed that was how those tools leaked to the public. So maybe that was the red flag. I don't know. Big worry for Apple and Google, I guess. The EU, European Union, has provisionally agreed on a law that would force Apple to allow third-party app stores on the iPhone sideloading and iMessage interoperability. It was even revealed in a discovery in the Epic versus Apple trial that Apple email messages from Apple executives saying we can't put iMessage on Android phones because then parents would buy cheap Android phones for their kids instead of expensive iPhones. So we can't allow that, which is pretty much admitting that they're doing it for competitive reasons. Okay, that's fine. I guess that's legal. I guess it's not good for customers. It's good for business. Finally, on a sad note, the inventor of the GIF has passed away. Actually, two passings this week. Stephen Wilhite died from COVID last week at the age of 74. He invented the GIF, graphics interchange format, for CompuServe. Remember that? CompuServe? It was in the 80s. It was the big online service before the internet was widespread, was public. People would use CompuServe even before AOL. And he was looking for a way to distribute images without using a lot of bandwidth, because in those days you had 300 bit per second modems. He invented the GIF in his spare time. Notice I'm saying GIF, not GIF. That's because Wilhite, from the rest of his life, insisted it's pronounced GIF. He won a Webby Award, and that was his acceptance speech. It's pronounced GIF, not GIF. So in honor of Steve Wilhite, I will from now on, if I remember. Wilhite said one of his favorite GIFs, the dancing baby. You remember that? It started, what was that lawyer show? Ally McBeal. Because she would have, you know, her biological clock was ticking or whatever. And so she'd see this image of a dancing baby, which actually didn't originate there. It was a demonstration graphic that came with a 3D program back in the day, turned into an animated GIF, then made it to Ally McBeal and spread around the world. He's not the creator of the dancing baby, but he is the creator of the GIF. And so his passing is noted. GIFs are still widely used. Actually, another passing this week, John Roach, who was the CEO at Tandy when they decided to create the TRS-80, which is for many of you and many of us, the first computer. It wasn't my first computer, but for many people, the first computer, a desktop microcomputer that retailed for under $600 in the 70s. That was the first introduction for many people, including some kind of very important computer scientists today. Their first computer, the Trash 80, they called it, 1977. By 1981, the best-selling computer of all time, beating out Apple's Apple II computer. John Roach, passed at the age of 83. Couple of sad notes, but you got, you know, these people are pioneers, and as you know, as we as the computer revolution gets older and longer in the tooth, this is going to happen. I'm sad to say. Anyway, I'm glad you were here, and I'm here, and I'll be here next week, and I hope you'll come by and bring your friends too as we talk high tech. Leo Laporte, the tech guy.
Are you ready for another trip into amateur radio history? I'm Bill Continelli, W2XOY, and I'll be back in a moment with another edition of the Ancient Amateur Archives, here on This Week in Amateur Radio. Backlogged, paralyzed, swamped, and overwhelmed. These are the words that describe the FCC in January 1977. The reason? Citizens banned radio applications. The CB craze had started in 1974 with the first gas crisis. Fueled by top 10 songs, TV shows, and movies, CB radio became an incredibly popular fad among the public in the days before computers, the internet, cable TV, or cellular phones. Prior to the gas crisis, the licensed CB population had stabilized at about 800,000. Now, over 500,000 applications per month poured into the FCC Gettysburg office. The peak was reached in January when 1 million applications came in. By the end of 1977, over 10 million CB licenses had been issued. The explosive growth in 11-meter activity, coupled with the unresolved Class E CB issue, caused increased friction between CBers and hams. The ARRL was still fighting the proposed reallocation of 2 MHz in our 220 band to Class E. Instead, the League suggested a new CB band at 900 MHz. Then, on April 4, 1977, the Class E fight was thrust into the public spotlight. Jack Anderson, in his nationally syndicated column, charged that the FCC was staffed by ham henchmen who conspired with the 300,000 amateurs to keep 9 million CBers from getting expanded frequencies. The ARRL, along with dozens of hams, sent rebuttals to the media. The friction gradually subsided when the FCC announced the 27 MHz CB band would be expanded from 23 to 40 channels. The Class E question was settled on October 13, 1977, when the FCC dropped the idea. Our 220 band was safe, for now. Ironically, the United States lost $200 million on the CB boom. How? Well, late in 1976, a federal court overturned the FCC's license fee structure. Rather than appeal the decision and/or overhaul their fee assessment procedure, the FCC suspended collection of all license fees effective January 1, 1977. A Class D CB license cost $20. You can do the math. Incidentally, amateurs benefited from the license fee suspension. A new or renewed license, except for the novice, used to cost $9. Now it was free. Amateur radio was growing in 1977. At the beginning of the year, there were 293,655 hams. By mid-year, the number was 313,000, and on December 1st, it was 327,000. This was a healthy 11% growth in 1 year and a 25% increase over the 1974 census. The biggest single reason was probably 2-meter FM. Hundreds of repeaters with the distinctive WR prefix covered the country coast to coast. The pages of QST were filled with ads for Crystal Control 2-meter FM rigs, such as the Midland 13500 and 13505, the Wilson 1402 and 1405, the Regency HR2B and HR312, the Genève GTX1 and GTX10, and the Heathkit HW202. With crystals for 12-channel operation, these units cost about $250. Counting inflation, that's about $700 today. For the 1977 operator who wanted the latest in synthesized technology, Clegg had the FMDX for $599, or $1,500 today, and Heathkit introduced the HW2036, which covered the 146 through 148 MHz FM segment of the 2-meter band. For those on a tight budget, VHF Engineering had a 1-watt 2-meter transmitter kit for $29.95, a 2-meter receiver kit for $69.95, and a 2-watt 4-channel 2-meter HT kit for $129.95. Technicians now had novice privileges but were still banned from 50.0 to 50.1 and 144 through 145 megahertz. However, the 2-meter repeater segment at 146 through 148 megahertz was becoming crowded. In response to several petitions, on November 4, 1977, the FCC opened a new repeater subband from 144.5 through 145.5 megahertz. In addition, they deleted the separate station license requirement for repeaters. Any amateur, except for novice, could now put up a repeater without prior FCC approval. Logging requirements for repeaters were simplified. Finally, technicians were given full access to the new repeater subband, although the 144.0 through 144.5 segment was still out of bounds for technicians. In other FCC news for 1977, on March 1st, instant upgrading appeared. Licensed amateurs could immediately use new privileges upon passing the test for a higher class license, rather than waiting 6 to 8 weeks for the overloaded FCC to send the new license. On July 1st, any extra class amateur could apply for a 1x2 call. Due to a 500% increase in amateur exams, as well as a massive workload, the FCC announced on August 18th that the CW sending test would be eliminated for all licenses above novice. However, the FCC had only one proposal that brought forth the wrath of the amateur community. Citing illegal CB operation on the 10.5-meter band, in other words, those frequencies between 27.405 and 28 megahertz, the FCC wanted to ban commercial amplifiers capable of operation between 24 and 35 megahertz and to require type acceptance on any amplifier that operated below 144 megahertz. Except for novice VXOs in the early 1970s, the FCC had never required type acceptance on any amateur transmitter. The amateur community strongly opposed this proposal. Hams were being punished for the crimes of others. The FCC promised an answer by 1978. In summary, 1977 was a good year for amateurs, but there were still some unfinished business. Would technicians get the full 2-meter band and, along with generals, regain the 50.0 through 50.1 megahertz segment they lost under incentive licensing? Would CB radio continue its massive growth and make more demands on amateur frequencies? Finally, would the FCC ban 10-meter amplifiers? The answers lie in 1978. This is Bill Continelli, W2XOY, for this week in amateur radio.
The South African Radio Astronomy Observatory has captured the most detailed images to date of what are known as ORCs, for odd radio circles, in a discovery astronomers are calling unprecedented. The circles themselves are nothing new. The first three were discovered in 2019 by astronomers at Australia's National Science Agency, CSIRO, using the Australian Square Kilometre Array Pathfinder. Archival data from the radio telescope imagery in India in 2013 contained the fourth image. The Australian radio telescope identified a fifth one last year. Scientists are curious as to why odd radio circles show up in radio waves, but are undetected by optical or X-ray telescopes. Astronomers theorize that the huge circles take about 1 billion years to reach their maximum size. Their diameter is about to be 10 times the diameter of the Milky Way, measuring about 1 million light years across. Some have a galaxy at their centers. ORCs beam out radio signals every 18 minutes on the average, but little else is known about them. That could change, though. Scientists said that with the newest images from South Africa's high-resolution radio telescope, they may be a bit closer to understanding them better.
Foundations of Amateur Radio. Identifying the problem is the first step in fixing it, and with that, I want to talk about emergencies. One of the very first things I was told about our amateur radio community was that we're here for when emergencies happen. Our purpose is to communicate, so in a crisis we can assist by supplying communication to the situation. I've talked about some of this before. Preparedness in the way of on-air training by contesting, in getting gear ready, and even exercises for when this occurs. There are amateur clubs dedicated to putting up repeaters for just such an eventuality. Recently, there was a local news item about radio amateurs banding together, sending gear to fellow amateurs who were hit by severe flooding that wiped out their shack, and with it their ability to communicate. Another event was a friend who lost a big chunk of his shack when his basement flooded. Across Australia and in other parts of the world in recent times, we've been witness to the most devastating fires that destroyed entire towns and communities, taking with it infrastructure, communications, not to mention stock, local flora and fauna, and entire wildlife ecosystems, bringing some to extinction levels. The destruction doesn't end there. War and famine, drought, cyclones, hurricanes or typhoons, snowstorms, heatwaves, and the like. All those situations can, to greater or lesser degree, benefit from amateur radio communications, either for amateurs affected or for the community at large. I started considering what would actually be required to be useful in such a situation. Could you be prepared for anything, or are you required to pick and choose? What does being prepared actually look like, and what steps can you take once it's happening? I asked myself if sending radio gear to amateurs who are affected by floods is the most effective way to actually help, or would it be better to pass the hat around and send the proceeds to their bank account? Should you as an amateur drive into an emergency area and start communicating, or are there better ways to help? There are local amateur radio emergency service groups under various names in different countries, some of which are highly effective, others much less so. One attempt I made was to join the local volunteer state emergency services. For several reasons, that didn't work out for me, but it remains a viable option for some. Joining those types of groups gives you a framework, but does it actually answer the underlying question, that of effectiveness? I have a drawer full of emergency service training manuals, each more dense than the next, but very little of it relates to amateur radio. Many pages are dedicated to search and rescue, staying alert, first aid, keeping alive, hand signals, logbooks, mapping, and the like. I'm left wondering why we, as a community with a proud century of activity, having one of the main principles as emergency communication, appear to have such a poor track record of actually considering what dealing with an emergency looks like, and what your own individual place could be in that situation. We document our radios, antennas, power supplies, contact, circuit board designs, contesting procedures, and all the rest of it, but we don't seem to do the same for emergencies. Why is that? In my opinion, it's time to document emergency amateur radio, and if you have already started, get in touch. I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima, Alpha Bravo.
The International Amateur Radio Union Satellite Frequency Coordination Panel reports that an application has been submitted for an amateur radio payload to be hosted on the brand new Chinese space station. In case you didn't know, the new Chinese space station has been in orbit for the last year. It is still under construction and is currently occupied by three astronauts. China's Tiangong space station, which is being constructed in low Earth orbit following the launch of its first module last May, is expected to have expanded room for astronauts, experiments, and now amateur radio. The International Amateur Radio Union's Satellite Frequency Coordination Panel reports that it received an application on March 8th for an amateur radio payload to be on board. The station is being proposed by the Chinese Radio Amateurs Club in cooperation with the Aerospace System Engineering Research Institute of Shanghai and the Harbin Institute of Technology. Previous news reports have noted that the Chinese manned space agency plans to have three astronauts on board continuously for a minimum of 10 years. One module will house the astronauts. The space station expects to use the remaining two of its three modules to host scientific experiments of researchers from all nations of the UN. The amateur radio station is applying to use portions of the VHF and UHF amateur radio band and will consist of communications by voice, repeater, AFSK digipeater, slow scan television, and other digital imaging modes. Not unlike the radios on board the International Space Station, the ham radios on the Chinese Space Station are intended for a variety of uses, including contacts with students to inspire careers in science, technology, engineering, and math. According to the application, the payload would launch in the third quarter of this year.
In amateur satellite news, Bruce Page, KK5DO, asks a question, and that is, what does it take to be a rover on satellite? Well, according to Bruce, very little. He says you can have two low-cost handheld transceivers, one for receive and one for transmit, a small beam antenna, a smartphone with satellite path prediction apps, and maybe a voice recorder or use an app on the smartphone to record the paths. Bruce says the voice recorder is handy because you don't have to log all the calls on paper and worry about missing one or two and not being able to tune the radio at the same time. Now, if you want something a little better, Bruce recommends going with a pair of mobile radios for FM or a dual band transceiver or an all mode radio that has 2 meters and 70 centimeters. This will allow you to work the SSB satellites. Bruce suggests that you might also think of mounting your antenna on a camera tripod so that you don't have to hold it. Then there are those who are serious and have a small azimuth elevation rotator to turn the beam as well as computer control. As Bruce says, satellites are fun. And like all the other facets of amateur radio, there's an easy way in, a more elaborate way in, and then the top of the line, of course. Pick the pieces you like and make it work. The travels you'll have and the contacts you'll make will be enjoyed by everyone.
After careful deliberation, the SPDX Contest Committee, together with Polish Amateur Radio Union, PZK, and the SPDX Club, has decided to cancel the 2022 SPDX Contest. Since the start of the war in Ukraine, Poland has taken in more than 2 million refugees. Polish radio amateurs offer Ukrainian refugees accommodation in their homes and their help and services in any way they can. Under these exceptional circumstances, the organizers have decided that this year's SPDX contest will be canceled and look forward to holding the contest in 2023.
According to the Ohio Penn DX and the Intrepid DX group, hams around the world are grieving the death of the noted DxPeditioner and humanitarian known as Zorro, JH1AJT. Zorro, whose name was Yasuo Miyazawa, became a silent key at 72 years of age on March 22nd. He had been diagnosed with cancer. Known as much for his optimistic outlook on life and his generous heart, Zorro was a key part of DxPeditions in Yemen, Laos, Ethiopia, and Bhutan, just to name a few. In 2015, Zorro received the Intrepid Spirit Award from the Intrepid DX Group for his achievements in Eritrea, Myanmar, and Bangladesh. His many humanitarian efforts include the establishment of a prep school in Japan that specializes in the education of students with special needs, and his gifts of thousands of dollars to programs in Myanmar to serve the nation's medical and educational needs. Zorro also created and endowed the Humanitarian Aid Fund of the International DX Association. A statement from one of that association's directors, Ralph Fedor, K0IR, lauded Zorro as a skilled operator who mentored and encouraged less experienced operators. The statement also praised him for his humanity. The statement said, through his schools and his humanitarian trips in Asia and Africa, he brought a better life to all of those he touched. The statement went on to add, the world lost a great man. He was truly a brother to us all.
Finland's National Amateur Radio Society, the SRAL, reports over 200 people have started training for an amateur radio license since the start of the year. A post by board director Timo Rinne, Oscar Hotel 5 Lima Lima Romeo, says that the beginning of the year has been fast-paced. Both the government and the SRAL office are currently understaffed, so there is plenty to do. Fortunately, the society has received help from active members and committees. The continuity of the in-house RA magazine was confirmed when Tommy Oscar Hotel 2 India Delta took over as editor. There are new winds blowing in the SRAL committees too. The concept of an automated station has been evolving over the years, but the related processes and radio amateur regulations have not kept pace with the development. A new working group, led by Eric, Oscar Hotel 2 Lima Alpha Kilo, has been set up to coordinate and develop the operation of automated stations. The competition committee will also sharpen their tools to increase contest activity. There will be more on this in forthcoming editions of RA Magazine. The full-scale war in Ukraine is closer to Finland than any other conflict since the Second World War. The proximity of the war, and the fact that the invading party is their neighbouring country, will certainly provoke strong emotions in all Finns and also in Finnish radio amateurs. It is natural that radio amateurs are also concerned about the situation and have sympathy with the people affected by the war. In the midst of all this, however, Timo Riina wants hams to remember the importance of the spirit of ham radio and the fact that radio amateurs themselves have not started this war. He said he did not want to ostracize citizens of any country, but to receive every radio amateur with the same openness and kindness regarding of nationality. The SRAL board director was particularly pleased with the educational activity that started at the beginning of the year. There are currently 3 elementary class courses running with a total of over 200 participants. The trainers are doing an excellent job, and it's hoped that this fresh crop of prospective radio amateurs will become new members of SRAL. In Finland, cooperation with important local partners is progressing in a good spirit. The SRAL board held a traditional spring meeting with the country's communications regulator, Traficom. It was agreed that cooperation will be intensified and meetings will be held more frequently. In addition, preparations are ongoing concerning the MPK partnership agreement as required by the autumn meeting. MPK delivers voluntary defence training in Finland. The draft agreement is scheduled to be submitted to the next meeting for agreement. OH5LLR said that the pandemic in Finland is also finally easing its grip, allowing for the return of some activities. Club nights have been restored and various events can be organised again. Long-awaited DxPeditions have been launched in several different countries, and hopefully Finnish world travellers will soon be able to set out to activate DxCC countries around the world. Even the famous July summer camp looks as though it will go ahead after a long break. Preparations for the camp have started, and progress will be announced in spring bulletins and the RA magazine. There's more at tinyurl.com/IARU-Finland. And Finland has 2 categories of license: the basic class, which is equivalent to the CEPT novice and UK intermediate license, and the general class, equivalent to the CEPT HAREC and UK full license.
Amateur radio researchers from NASA's Ham Radio Science Citizen Investigation, HAMSCI, have observed for the first time giant waves in the upper atmosphere known as large-scale traveling ionospheric disturbances, or LSTIDs for short. The observational results appear to demonstrate the effects of LSTIDs on radio communications, as well as adding to the understanding about how the wave interface itself functions. The results were published in the American Geophysical Union Journal, Geophysical Research Letters.
The Summits on the Air program, known as SOTA, was launched in England and Wales on the 2nd of March 2002. Since then, it's expanded massively to over 100 associations on all major world continents and has over 24,000 participants. A special award has been launched to celebrate SOTA's 20th birthday. Participants can obtain a certificate for their best 20 days of chasing or activating, and there will be separate certificates for each activity. Logs should be entered as normal on the SOTA website, and the database will pick your 20 highest scoring days out of your logs for the whole year, from March 2nd, 2022 to March 1st, 2023. These certificates will be downloadable from the database and free of charge. This is not a contest, so the results will be presented in alphabetical callsign order. The SOTA management team would like there to be a lot of activity during the 20th anniversary year, and as such, the activity runs for a whole year to give plenty of time to take part. Some special event stations have already been operational to celebrate the anniversary. The Welsh SOTA Association manager, Roger Dallimore, Mike Whiskey Zero India Delta X-Ray, has been operating Golf Bravo 2 Oscar Tango Alpha from the summit of Minid Akum, SOTA reference Golf Whiskey Stroke November Whiskey 076, on the northernmost of the Clwydian Range summits during the month of March. SOTA management team member Tom Reed, Mike 1 Echo Yankee Papa, will be operating Golf Bravo 2-0 Sierra Oscar Tango Alpha from the summit of The Cloud, reference Golf Stroke Sierra Papa 015, from the 2nd to the 29th of April. More special event calls are planned for the forthcoming 20th birthday of SOTA in Northern Ireland, Scotland and the USA. And Shane Siggins, Golf 6 Whiskey Bravo Sierra from Preston in Lancashire, has achieved the SOTA Mountain Goat status. That's for reaching 1,000 activator points. And he's made the vast majority of his contacts on 2 meters FM. Shane reports feeling part of a very special community, with a loyal band of recognised chasers being worked on most activations, and expresses appreciation to the programme for encouraging him to explore lots of new hills and mountains. Shane has enjoyed the company of his partner on most activations, who joins in with route planning and tenor assembly and so on. They're now looking forward to some SOTA activity further afield, including abroad. For more information about Summits on the Air, please visit www.sota.org.uk.
The National Radio Centre at Bletchley Park has opened its doors again following a brief COVID-related closure. Visitors are again welcome at the Radio Society of Great Britain National Radio Centre at Bletchley Park. The centre reopened on Monday, March 28th. Having been shot after many members of its volunteer team had fallen ill with COVID-19. While visitors are still encouraged to wear face masks, they are not now mandatory. Amateur radio operators will have to wait a little longer to operate from the GB3RS amateur radio station on the site, however, as it remains unavailable. The radio room itself is open, and groups may visit in small numbers. RSGB members will be allowed to use their vouchers for free entry to the center, and it is no longer necessary to book arrival times in advance.
In 1998, two members of the AIR Amateur Radio Club in Scotland started the Northern Lights Award, which quickly morphed into the International Lighthouse and Lightship Weekend. Since then, it has grown and become a premier event in the worldwide amateur radio calendar, and this year celebrates its 25th anniversary. Its success is due to the fact that it has few rules, is free, and is not a contest, but a fun weekend. In 2014, the annual weekend hit the highest number of registered lighthouses ever to be involved, 544 in 56 countries. One of the founders, Mike Dalrymple, Golf Mike 4 Sierra Uniform Charlie, passed away in December 2005, and the other, John Forsyth, was not involved after the first few years. But Kevin, VK2 Charlie Echo, created the ILLW website in the year 2000, and with the help of Ted, Whiskey 8 Tango Tango Sierra, they created a list of eligible lighthouses and a list of registrations for each year's event, including an online registration form. There was no doubt that the internet was to become the backbone of the event's administration. There are quite a few entrants who've been participating for many years, some since the first year in 1998. Many go to great lengths and expense to set up temporary stations in order to take part. The response to this fun weekend has been quite amazing. The past 2 years have been affected to some extent by the COVID pandemic, but hopefully numbers will be back to normal this year. Normally held on the third full weekend in August, this year it will run for the 48 hours of the 20th and the 21st of August. Just over 100 registrations have already been received. Several suggestions had been made as to how the 25th anniversary milestone could be celebrated, but after much thought, the organisers have decided to dedicate the occasion to the people of Ukraine.
And now, with his segment on how to successfully compose a public service announcement to promote your radio club meeting or hamfest on local broadcast radio, here is Arizona's own Greg Stoddard, KF9MP.
In the last four segments on promoting your not-for-profit ham radio club's events, we created a public service announcement and gathered names and addresses of local media outlets We discussed other places to post your event flyers and where to mail your PSAs. This time we'll cover some of the realities of free promotions in these days of media conglomeration and downsizing. In the good old days of broadcast radio, even the boss's secretary had a secretary. Today, radio and TV stations often operate on skeleton crews. Computers playing WAV files or commanding a stack of CD changers take the place of live on-the-air talent. At stations which once employed 15 people, now operate on 5 or so, with many jobs contracted out or supplied by out-of-state ownership. This sad but real state of broadcasting has a direct effect on your ability to promote your nonprofit club's event. They simply do not have the manpower to research, verify, or prep your PSA for air. This is all the more reason why it must be ready to use as is when it arrives at the radio station. The more you do to make it ready for them, the more likely it is to be put on the air. The professional appearing PSA is also more likely to be read as is if it looks right too. If there is a fatal flaw in any of the important features in your PSA, it is always easier for the person who actually reads it on the air to simply use the next one instead. A traditional item in the broadcast studio is the PSA folder. This three-ring folder usually sits right in front of the announcer and not only contains your PSA, but also other information for the DJ. Radio stations usually use a three-ring folder with clear plastic sleeves. The announcer's time is scarce, so your PSA needs to be short, easy to read as is. It must not contain any grammar or spelling mistakes, should be double-spaced, and the portion to be read on the air should be visibly obvious to the reader in an instant. An example of this would be that in your PSA, the portion to be actually read on the air should be the only area on that page which is in bold text and double-spaced, so it jumps out at the reader. Another trick is to use colored paper, but not the neon-like color. If all the pages in the PSA folder are white except yours, which is canary yellow, it makes it easier for the announcer to flip through the PSA folder to that page next time. You could put your PSA into a clear plastic sleeve and mail it to the radio station too. Never send a media outlet a handwritten PSA or ones that contain spelling and grammar mistakes, and always include contact information. Your club should designate a main contact person who has all the access to all the pertinent information about what is mentioned in your PSA and background information about your club, especially its nonprofit status. Retired people make the best contacts since they are usually easy to get a hold of during business hours. And my final strategy for promotional success is if your club has a good speaker, record your PSA into a solid 30-second recording and burn it onto a CD and mail it to the radio stations on your list. Again, include some free admission tickets and provide a hard copy of the PSA, which is on the CD. This is the ultimate lazy but most successful approach to promotional success. This is Greg Stoddard, Kilo Fox 9 Mike Papa, reporting for This Week in Amateur Radio.
And finally this week, from recently leaked documents found on amateur radio sites across the internet, it appears that amateur radio equipment manufacturers are about to part with tradition and change S meters to go to S10 instead of S9. This has caused a huge debate across all amateur radio platforms of social media. While some hams see the higher signal reports as a boost to otherwise poor conditions, many are outraged that only people with money for new radios get to see these stronger signals on the new meters. Speaking on the condition of anonymity, Hitoshi Yakamoto from Yaesu said they wanted to do something truly innovative for ham radio. After much discussion, the design team agreed an extra S unit was perfect, although one of the new engineers said he couldn't recall studying S units in school at all. The debates are intense. Contesters are wondering if everyone is now 5'10", or just those with the new radios. British and US hams are united in their opposition, complaining it's yet another example of metric being used to confuse everyone.
This Week in Amateur Radio is heard around the world on amateur radio repeater systems, streaming on the internet, or on great low-power FM broadcast stations like WGXC-FM, part of the Waveform, on 90.7 MHz in Akron, New York, serving Greene County and the southern regions of New York's Capital District. Many of the news and information items heard on this edition of This Week in Amateur Radio have been provided by the American Radio Relay League, the AWRL Audio News Service, and the AWRL Letter, the Southgate Amateur News Service, Steve Richards, G4 Hotel Papa Echo, and the Southgate Vibes News Service, AMSAT, the Radio Amateurs of Canada, the FCC, the Radio Society of Great Britain, and Ofcom, the South African Radio League, the International Amateur Radio Union, the Wireless Institute of Australia, and the Australian Communications and Media Authority, the New Zealand Association of Radio Transmitters, the Amateur Radio Newsline, the RAIN Hamcast, Eric Guth, 4Z1UG and QSO Today, QRZ.com, the Tech Guy, Leo Laporte, the International Telecommunications Union, and various news sources on the Internet.
With special thanks to all our weekly news sources and to you, our listeners, that wraps up this edition of This Week in Amateur Radio. If you would like to write to us, you can find everything you need, including archive editions of the news service, at our website at twiar.net. And now, for all of us at This Week in Amateur Radio headquarters and all our news team around the world, this is Will Rogers, K5.